Good afternoon, everyone, here in person and online. It's a great pleasure for me to be able to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Jeff Schoenau, who is a professor of soil fertility and a professional agrologist in the Department of Soil Science here in the College of Agriculture and Bioresources. Professor Schoenau holds Saskatchewan, the SRP chair in soil nutrient management, funded by the Ministry of Agriculture. Jeff was born here in Saskatchewan, grew up on the family farm in Central Butte, and continues to farm with his wife, Lynn. Jeff holds a number of awards and accolades. He is a member of the Ag Institute of Canada. He's a professional agrologist and recently was inducted into the Saskatchewan Agricultural Hall of Fame. And so we have greatness amongst us and look forward to your presentation today, Jeff. I'll leave it to you to introduce the topic and launch into your presentation.
Great. thank you very much, Trevor. It's great to be here this afternoon to have the opportunity to be part of the Ag Bio, a seminar series on advancements in agriculture, and to talk a little bit about my work in soil fertility and nutrient management, 40 years and forward. And you may be wondering where that 40 years is coming from. I'm a little older than 40 years. In fact, I'm the same age as that 4010 tractor there, so you can guess that. But actually, thinking a little bit about this when I was putting together the presentation, 40 years, I came to the U of S here as a start my undergraduate program in 1980. And in 1983, I actually started my research actually as an undergraduate thesis project with Dr. Jim Jermida. And my thesis topic was the effect of crop residues on nutrient availability. And so that's just about 40 years. And thinking as well, I'm actually starting a new project this year looking at the effect of straw removal on soils. So it's amazing how some things just kind of continue on and the topic and the interest in it, there's always new things to be considered. So I guess when we think about, kind of research I do, I guess if I was going to put it into two words, nutrient management. And why is that research important? Well, we recognize that nutrients, fertilizers are often the greatest input cost on a farm. And certainly that's the case on my farm and many others as well. So there's a very strong underlying economic reason why growers want to be the best managers of nutrients that they can be. And I like the adage, nutrients, use them, don't lose them. Because if you follow that mindset, that's not only of economic advantage, agronomic advantage, but of course it's of environmental advantage as well. We want to keep those nutrients, get them into the plant where they're needed, not end up having them go somewhere else like to the water or the air. And so when we think about nutrients, we maybe first thing that comes to mind are commercial fertilizers, but there's a lot of other plant nutrient containing materials out there, as I show, manures and composts and many others that we've looked at in our research work. And we need to consider the management of those nutrients, folks, in the context of cropping systems as well, the kind of crop rotations, the kind of systems that we have out there in Western Canada and other parts of the world. So the general goal of my research program really is to develop, evaluate, and also disseminate improved soil and nutrient management strategies for our province, Canada, and the world. And I'm going to talk a little bit at the end about some of the international efforts as well towards this goal. So the kinds of things that I look at are soil fertility and fertilizers. I look at different kinds of organic amendments as well, manures, composts, and some other novel ones I'll talk a little bit about. Cropping practices and how that influences soil quality. That's what we used to call it. Now it's called soil health, carbon storage, and greenhouse gas mitigation, which have become very important topics recently. And I guess from a basic science aspect, folks, really I'm interested in nutrient cycling processes, how those different nutrients cycle through the system. If we think of the soil, crop livestock continuum. We realize that the nutrients are essential to the functioning of that and really providing us all with agronomic, economic, and environmental well-being if they're managed properly. A little bit of history then, I think, in terms of you know, thinking about the work that I've been involved with in the past and how things have changed over time, going all the way back to the 1980s. And perhaps there's a few folks here online and maybe in the audience here, I'm not so sure about that, who would remember the 1980s fairly clearly. But actually at that point in time, I would say in general, soils were not in particularly good shape. There was a lot of erosion that had taken place, wind erosion, water erosion, lost a lot of organic matter in our soils. And in fact, part of my PhD research work that I did was comparing nutrients, soil organic matter in native compared to, at that time, 70-year cultivated fields across the soil climatic zones of Saskatchewan, and could see that very much at that time. And at about the same time, air-conditioned tractors came along, and I sure didn't mind being out there in the field in that air-conditioned tractor, but really what I was doing in a lot of cases, it was kind of what we used to call recreational tillage. And it didn't do a lot for the soil. And the economy was also hurting as well at that time. We had some pretty bad droughts, interest rates were high, and people left the agricultural industry. And I think it was a matter of striving towards efficiency and survival that folks really started to consider alternatives to that traditional cereal tillage fallow system. And so some enterprising folks out there began to think about, is there a better way? Direct seeding. Continuous cropping, maybe we can get rid of this fallow system. So folks like Dr. Don Rennie, a very important advocate early on of reducing that tillage and direct seeding, multi-crop rotation, pulses, Dr. L. Slinkard bringing in lentils as one of the first legumes that growers could have as an option to cereals and the benefits that subsequently provided in rotation. And of course, canola. The development of that is a very important cash crop and certainly a big picture today in the industry. And I guess when we think about canola, and maybe one of the things that comes to mind when we talk about canola as a crop, as a nutrient, is sulfur. And so part of my PhD research work there, and I was very lucky to have the excellence guidance supervision of Dr. Jeff Bettany and also Dr. John Stewart, who had worked a lot in sulfur in the past. One of the things that I did in my PhD research work was develop a stable sulfur isotope tracer technique and use that for following sulfur through the soil plant system. And the kind of equipment that we had then, the way that we prepared our samples, it was kind of a messy, stinky operation. We were working back in the old John Mitchell building there. And when we moved into this new building here, I brought all that old equipment over here and set it up, worked on it for a while, but it wasn't very pleasant to use. And I don't think people liked the smell too much of that sulfide that was being produced. And so it kind of dropped off, but you know, again, coming all the way to the future here now, or the present and looking towards the future, we have some new mass spectrometry equipment being installed upstairs, and we've always had our mass spectrometer lab, and I'm looking forward now with the facilities and the new equipment that we have to maybe getting back into some of this sulfur isotope work that I left behind about 30 years ago. So again, past becomes present, becomes future. It was about this time I kind of realized as well that there was more to Saskatchewan than just prairie. There's actually trees. And so some of the first work, and actually one of the first PhD students that I had, worked on a project called Boreas that was, and NASA was actually part of this, looking at the influence of the boreal forest on the global carbon cycle. And so we were on the ground looking at carbon and nutrient stocks in boreal forest soils. There were tower measurements, and NASA even had a U-2 plane up there that was doing some measurements of carbon dioxide gas in the atmosphere. And we were interested in not only carbon dioxide, but also methane. And so some of that first work that we were involved with, Holly Rask was my first PhD student, and she worked on this chamber techniques for measuring methane fluxes in boreal forest peatlands. And we can see how those chamber techniques have proceeded on to today, where there's lots and lots of chambers out there in the field being used to measure greenhouse gases like not only methane, but nitrous oxide as well. We did observe that litter layer in that boreal forest was a major storehouse of carbon and nitrogen. Agricultural implications of that is that, you know, you can see now when that litter layer was pushed off those fields and burned versus retained in terms of having those soils better fertility and organic matter even today. And we did observe that, in fact, some of those open bogs in the boreal north were actually pretty significant fluxes of methane compared to the covered peatlands that we were comparing those open bogs to. Moving on into the 1990s, things were moving along. No-till was starting to be adopted on a wider scale. New crops continued to be added into the rotation. Conversion of marginal lands to permanent cover. Grain prices still weren't great in a lot of the 1990s, and so people were interested. We take these marginal lands, these heartache lands, and annual cropping, and put them into permanent cover. And it was also about this time, folks, that there was a big initiative in the prairies and in Saskatchewan to expand hog production. So surrounding those kind of things, you realize there's some soil fertility and nutrient management implications, some questions, some issues that needed to be addressed. And in order to do this kind of research, of course, anything you need to do, you need some tools. And so I run 6 old 3-ton trucks from the 1970s and 80s out there to move grain around in my farm, Lynn and I can tell you to keep any of those old ones going, you need to have those wrenches in the truck, because they're not the most reliable. And I guess to this end, it was about this time that we were thinking about better ways that we might be able to assess nutrient availability in the soil, apart from the traditional extractions that have been around since the end of the Second World War. And so this led to the development of the plant root simulator technology. And Mr. Ken Greer, who worked in the Department of Soil Science and was aware of what we were doing and was involved in some of the research I was doing, took that technology out, commercialized that. And today, the company has over 30 employees in Saskatchewan making fertilizer recommendations to growers across the prairies and the northern USA, and used as a real research tool in 58 countries, as shown there on the map there, where the PRS probe has been used in research. And there's one there at the very bottom in Antarctica. Yeah, there's some probes out there in the field, and there's some penguins walking around there on the shore, and I'm not sure what water body that is beside it, but it's now a widely used research tool. And this is a slide that I borrowed from Edgar Hammermeister, who's agronomy manager with the Western Ag, and put this together. These are the peer-reviewed research papers written using PRS data. There's just about 600 papers out there now. Average impact journal impact factor for the PRS in journals is 3. And a lot of graduate student projects have also been conducted using this as a tool. And we've continued and others to use this technology as part of the research work. Also in the 1990s, I had the opportunity to work with the Prairie Agriculture Machinery Institute to develop and evaluate low disturbance manure injection technology. And I really think this led to the realization that manure, hey, yeah, it smells, but it's also a very, very important resource for the organic matter and the nutrient that it contains. And so we worked with PAMI to develop this technology and found that in-soil injection was indeed a very effective way to not only reduce the odor, but also improve the recovery of nutrients in that manure. The result of that, folks, is that nearly all the liquid manure that's applied out there now is injected, and in many cases, low disturbance. So not just annual cropland, but compatible with zero till and also application into forages as well. Converting marginal lands to permanent cover. I mentioned that as something. There was a lot of initiatives related to that. And we were interested in determining how did that influence the soil organic matter content, nutrient availability. And so we were very lucky at that time that Ducks Unlimited had a program in which they had a program where they were having a number of growers, farmers who were collaborators who would take this marginal annually cultivated land and seed it down into a permanent cover. dense nesting cover. And so we could go out across the province, and particularly in some of these areas like the Missouri Coteau, up in northeastern Saskatchewan, some of these real hilly, marginal, heartbreak kind of lands, and look at the effect of that anywhere from 8 to 12 years of grass seed down compared to business as usual annual crop cultivation. And this was some of the first work that really documented that taking those lands and putting them into permanent cover significantly increased the soil organic matter, the carbon stored in the soil, and also a number of other soil quality benefits like the ability to release available nitrogen from growing those forages across Saskatchewan. And that work continues on today, as I'll explain, with folks like Dr. Bart Lardner, looking at different forage systems and how that is influencing soil organic carbon and nitrogen stocks. We also took a look at organic inorganic fertilizer synergies and some very interesting work. One set of studies was looking at combining elemental S with sewage sludge from the city of Saskatoon. This was Dr. John Gillies in the Environmental Engineering Department. If we could produce fertilizer with enhanced oxidation and plant availability. This was, a great concept, but what we did is we pelletized it, and unfortunately some of the pellets that we made were a little bit too dense, and so they didn't release or break apart fast enough. But it's interesting to see that technology now kind of actually being used in the form of elemental S combined with compost in a product called Biosol that's out there used as a sulfur fertilizer. The other thing that we looked at as in terms of using waste products as fertilizer sources was waste gypsum, waste wallboard. And if you've been around Saskatoon long enough, you remember that there was a wallboard manufacturing plant up on 51st Street, Domtar, and had the opportunity to work with an engineering consulting company, Clifton Associates, and they were wondering, what could we do with this wallboard? Well, actually, we took some of that wallboard, it's gypsum, and took it out into the field in the growth chamber and found it to be actually quite an effective sulfur source. So in the end, an entrepreneur came along and took that wallboard pile and managed to move it out as a fertilizer source and cleaned up the site. And now it's been developed. So an example of how you can turn something that contains nutrient that seems like it's a waste material, a burden, and take it out there and make some good use of it. Moving on into the 2000s, cropping systems then become a little bit more complex. We see technology advancing, cost of production also going up. And I think it's about that time we're starting to see a lot more attention being put towards some of the environmental issues that surround nutrient losses. And I have the picture there on the right just to remind me that the landscape and looking at management of agricultural landscapes rather than just thinking of soils or crops, I think is really, really important. And I just like to say that the soil science department really a pioneer, a leader, folks like Dan Pennick, Fran Wally, Angela Bedard Hahn, and really looking at soils in the landscape and leading to some of what we're doing right now is actually doing research on a landscape scale, making sure that we encompass in our studies effects of a treatment, not only at the mid slope, so to speak, but also in those depressional areas and upslopes as well. So landscape-based research is a very important part of my research work that really relates to a lot of the development of that concept in the Department of Soil Science. One thing I'd like to talk a little bit about for just a couple of minutes, and maybe people aren't as aware of this as maybe some of the other research activities I've been involved in, but work that looks at the phytotoxicity and persistence of soil active herbicides. And this is work we really got started back in the 1990s and continued on over the years. And a very important part of this is Dr. Anis Migelski, who has worked in my research program for many years, looking at these soil active herbicides, flucarbazone, thiancarbazone, sulfentrazone, pyroxasulfone. A lot of these newer herbicides have soil activity. And when they first came out, a lot of the work was done in areas, parts of the world that had a lot different soils than what we have here in Saskatchewan. Not a lot known about their behavior. And as a result, a few years back, 15 years or so, there was a lot of issues out there surrounding herbicide carryover, crop injury issues, grower complaints, insurance claims. And so there was a real need to understand how these soil active herbicides behaved in prairie soils. And so Anna worked to develop some very efficient bioassays, root and shoot length inhibition bioassays, and then used these. And there was also a number of graduate students involved in this, and also working with Rick Holm and Eric Johnson and others to determine and predict the impact of soil properties on phytotoxicity and carryover. And we had a lot of industry support, so support from companies like FMC, Arista Life Sciences, BASF, to help understand what's going on with these herbicides in our soils. And we came to realize one of the big is that organic matter is a really important factor affecting the phytotoxicity and the persistence of those kinds of compounds in our soils. And as a consequence, that's been used by the industry to develop soil-specific guidelines for growers that I think have gone a long way to reduce the number of issues, problems that are cropping up out there in the field related to these compounds. Another one, it was identification of superior cattle overwintering systems for cow-calf producers, working with Dr. Bart Lardner and his group, and from a nutrient standpoint, finding that in-field feeding out there is more efficient in the nutrient recycling and certainly more economical than in-yard lot feeding. And if you think of those cows, as Paul Yanish, the graduate student who worked with Bart, and I used to say four-legged fertilizer factories, depositing that nutrient as fecal material and urine directly in the field promotes more efficient recycling of that nutrient compared to feeding in the yard, where we lose a lot of nutrient in the yard before it has a chance to get out to the field. And this kind of work again continues on today, looking at different types of feeding systems. I would be remiss if I didn't talk about 4R strategies for fertilization. I think everybody's familiar with the concept of 4R, the right source, the right rate, the right time, the right place to get that nutrient into the plant where you want it. So we've done research work over the years, for example, looking at the most effective forms of sulfur and phosphorus for canola, pulses, cereal crops. And we've been able to use the Canadian light source, so working with Dr. Derek Peak, to look at the fate of these sulfur and phosphorus forms in the soil and identify them. Looking at best rate and placement of fertilizer for annual crops and forages, nailing down some of the requirements of crops, some of the newer crops like faba beans, for example, working with folks in the Crop Development Center. Also safe rates for seed row placed fertilizer for all crops. And those that work that we have done with safe rates of fertilizer that you can put in the seed row with different crops, different fertilizer products, that's been incorporated into our provincial guidelines and fact sheets. And some of our most recent work looking at micronutrients, crop responses to micronutrients at different times in the rotation. Growers have lots and lots of questions about micronutrients, and I think we're helping to shed some light on this as well. Comes to nutrient placement, that's an area that we've worked on, and back in the zero, when zero till was just first starting to come on stream, and the development of that technology, questions about how can you most effectively place nutrient in a no-till system. And I remember working with Les Henry many years ago, looking at how that banding and residual phosphorus in the soil created quite a bit of micro-scale variability, which we've since looked at how do you account for that in sampling and even what are the implications of that stratification of P when it comes to things like phosphorus runoff. Well, we found that you can place nitrogen away from the seed row and get good response. In terms of fate of fertilizer and manure, one of my graduate students, Dr. Tom King, in his PhD work, developed a technique for taking intact slabs of soil out of the field, maintaining the structure, and then using those in an insulated box and applying snow to do a simulated snowmelt runoff that actually was a pretty good synthesis or representation of the snowmelt process in the field, and very applicable to small plot research. We've used that to look and continue to use that in studies to look at how different nutrient management practices affect nutrient export and runoff. Bottom line, what we've found and documented, get it in the ground. In-soil placement enhances availability and certainly reduces those losses in runoff compared to the surface placement. And again, the Canadian light source, a very valuable tool we found in revealing the speciation, the fate of phosphorus and sulfur species, actually can enable us to identify a lot of sulfur compounds in the soil that back in the 1980s, when I was doing my PhD work, only alternative was to use that stinky old apparatus we called the Johnson Nishida. So we've come along a long way. Precision agriculture, that's been part of my research over the years and continues to be. Some work a few years back looking at crop protein yield relationships to at harvest to identify by field nitrogen limitations and use that as part of the prescription or basis for adjusting nitrogen rates across the field for a following crop. And that was work that was done in collaboration with the engineering folks and also Case New Holland. And also some work on precision subsoiling to address compacted soils with Dr. Bing Si. And what that work really showed was that it wasn't economical to subsoil an entire field. But if you honed in and zeroed in on those areas in the field like wheel tracks that you could identify as being compacted, then it was an economical practice to apply that subsoiling. Crop nutrition and quality is very important. And here looking at things like nutrient requirements of different crops like soybean, working with Dr. Tom Warkinen and faba bean with Dr. Bert Vandenberg, nitrogen fixation, very, very important with working with Dr. Diane Knight in pulse crops, looking at transfer of nitrogen from the pulse crop to a following a crop that's growing. Also in this area of crop quality, some work on biofortification, some fertilization strategies, and that included a look at zinc fertilization, zinc fertilizer forms, and application strategies as another way to increase the zinc content of grains. And that's important because our pulse crops like lentils, a lot of those are marketed into parts of the world in the Middle East where zinc deficiency exists in the population. And that certainly can help higher zinc content to bioavailability in the marketability of our pulse crops that we grow. Bioenergy crops and byproducts. Bioenergy is something we see more interest in these days and indeed in the past as well. And we were some work that was done by Ryan Hangs in his PhD program with willow, identified some clones that were very tolerant to salinity. Looked at nutrient requirements and removal, nutrient cycling in these biomass energy crops. And as far as byproducts of biofuel production, a lot of work by a PhD student, Kayla Dalatabi, he published a lot of papers out of his PhD work, looking at chars, biochar, ash, distiller grains, manure from cattle fed distillers grains, as the kinds of amendments that in order to return those nutrients that are contained in those harvested products used to make that energy back to the soil to increase the sustainability of the system. And what we found is that things like thin stillage, distiller's grain, ash are really good fertilizers when they're applied to the soil. There's some challenges in how you handle them, how do you get them on there, but they are good sources of nutrients in many instances. Chars like biochars, important thing we found, they're very effective in reducing nitrous oxide emissions, kind of like the enhanced efficiency additives that have been observed to decrease nitrous oxide emissions when added to nitrogen fertilizers. Chars appear to be able to do the same thing and also retain those nutrients and protect them against losses. Moving on, I think to where we are today, some examples of current projects and one we've just wrapped up is precision cattle manure management. And here what we're talking about is using variable rate application according to long-term productivity, using appropriate setback from water bodies. And what we found in this 5-year project out at the Livestock Forage Center of Excellence at Clavette is really that variable rate seems very promising as a way to obtain more uniform production, nutrient distribution across the field, and also observing reduced nutrient, coliform, and hormone content concentrations in runoff, and also working with Rich Farrell in those watershed basins, seeing some reduced nitrous oxide production as well. So seems to be a real benefit from that precision application of manure concept compared to a traditional constant rate approach. Another project working on, kind of related to, improving soil productivity and also precision agriculture as well, building productivity of eroded knolls. We're improving the quality of our soils out there through our no-till practices, but some of those soils suffered a lot of decline in productivity due to loss of soil over the years back in the early years of cultivation. And so what we've been finding in this is that the addition of phosphorus, micronutrient fertilizers can help in rebuilding the productivity of those knolls, but often cannot replace all the benefits that topsoil provides. And that's why it's really important to keep that soil in place to begin with. So one of the treatments out there, actually I call it our upper level control, was actually we went down into the depressions where that soil had been eroded to, took that 40-10 out there with the front end loader and brought the soil back up onto the plots and put it out there on the field as our kind of top end control. This is kind of the situation. This shows what topsoil is really worth. And we could certainly see that. Forage, grazing, cropping systems, and soil properties. One of the things that we've been working on lately is salt-tolerant grasses, working with Dr. Biletgu and his breeding program with both salt-tolerant alfalfa and grasses, and the benefits that can have on properties and productivity. And I think one of the really important things we've observed, we've had a site out at Central Butte where we've set up treatments on saline soils and equivalent non-saline areas of the same field. And what we're seeing now with that salt tolerant grass, it takes a while to catch and gets established. But over the years, we start to see growth of that forage on that salt affected soil that is the same. And actually last year, just looking at the numbers, we actually got better growth of the grass on the saline area than the non-saline. I think that's pretty exciting, both from a productivity standpoint and also from a carbon sequestration standpoint as well. Long-term conservation cropping systems and soil organic matter. One thing I'd like to mention, a study that we did looking at 21 years of soil conservation management, taking samples that were archived back in 1996 from farm fields across Saskatchewan, across the prairies by Agriculture Canada as part of the Prairie Soil Carbon Balance Project, and taking and sampling those same areas in the field across the prairies again in 2018, showed significantly higher soil organic carbon content and also higher microbial biomass. Microbial biomass being a very good indicator of soil health and quality. So I think that's a testament to the fact that the kinds of management practices that we've been employing in our cropping systems here in the prairies, that direct seeding, extended rotation, using legumes in rotation, is making our soils better compared to what we had 20 years ago. Sod seeding, non-bloat legumes to rejuvenate old pastures. What's the effect on soil carbon, nitrogen, nutrients? These are things that we've looked at in previous research and continue to look at today. One thing I'd like to mention as a kind of a new system, and a lot of folks looking at this, and including myself in my research program from the standpoint of soil fertility, nutrient cycling, is intercropping. And we observe intercropping of oil seeds with pulse crops, those grain legumes, particularly has benefits because of the addition of nitrogen from the biological nitrogen fixation, and also able to document transfer of nitrogen from the legume to the non-legume partner as it grows over the season. And also legumes are great scavengers of phosphorus and other nutrients. They're highly mycorrhizal. And this can also, be a contributor to the synergy that we observed in this research work that we recently did between crops. And that's especially beneficial for low input or organic growers who really don't have a lot of options for bringing nutrient externally into the system. For our fertilizer management projects that we have, phosphorus, nitrogen, fertilizer, form, rate, placement, timing effects on yield, recovery, and fate, and also losses in runoff water. Finding there that, and this is work by Blake Wiseth as part of his PhD work, less soluble fertilizers have reduced availability, but they also have less loss in runoff water as well. So there may be a negative, but there's also a positive there as well. And looking at management of drained wetland basins in consolidation of wetlands on a field into one larger wetland area, what happens to those drained wetlands basins? They can be a source of additional nutrient export if water's moving through those. Practices like growing forages in there, using variable rate application, a strategic tillage appears to be an effective way to reduce the amount of water, amount of nutrient contained in that water moving through those basins and off of them to other parts of the landscape. Chars, we've been looking at how chars influence both nutrient retention and loss, and also a supply of nutrients. So chars that we've been working with in collaboration with Dr. Ajay Dalai in engineering, looking at them as both a source of phosphorus in some cases, depending on the source material, but also can be a sink for nutrients as well because of their high sorptive ability. And finally, I think a lot of interest in that we have in fertility and disease relationships because of, and I think we'll hear about this in some of the talks that are going to come down the road. Certainly disease has become an issue in our cropping systems for some crops. And so we're looking at how plant nutrition, nutrients like chloride, micronutrient metals like copper and zinc may interact to influence the incidence of disease in the crop. Internationally, way back in the 1980s, I was involved with Potash and Phosphate Institute of Canada, PPIC, which became IPNI. I had some projects that they brought to scientists from the different soil and fertilizer institutes across China. Sponsored them here for a couple of months. They spent time in my lab. We toured around Saskatchewan. We went out to the farm. We conducted research projects, and it was a very valuable, I think, a training program experience and for both them and us here in Saskatchewan. A little bit later, the Ethiopia project, CETA project, led by Dr. Mermont and Dr. Grievers. An important part of that project was student exchange, where students from Ethiopia came here and also students from Canada went there. And I know Trevor and I had a graduate student from Ethiopia, and actually my last PhD student from Ethiopia just finished here a couple of years ago. Mongolia was another CETA project involved that I was involved with and others as well. And an important part of that was introduction of soil conservation technologies. So Degi Chulin-Batar was a PhD student who worked with myself and Rick Holm on looking at interdisciplinary barriers to the introduction of no-till conservation management. And I think I can say that actually Mongolia, a lot of that technology now has been adopted there, and things are better there now than they were before. And most recently, some of my international efforts, sub-Saharan Africa, working with folks like Dr. Peak, looking at microdosing fertilizer, cropping systems. And I really think that the international work is something that now that COVID's over, hopefully we can start to build some momentum in that area, because I think that's important to continue that. I learn lots from that. I guess finally, looking ahead, where's my program going? Well, starting some research work on the effect of straw harvesting, straw management, because there's increasing demands on our fields to not only take the grain off, but also the straw for various purposes. It may be for pulp production. It may be for ethanol, cellulosic ethanol. So how does that influence the soil in terms of its health, of nutrient cycling, of crop production? Sod seeding, legume reintroduction, some work on that is going to be beginning. Improving productivity, increasing carbon storage, reducing greenhouse gas in marginal lands. That's some ongoing work that has been supported by my NSERC discovery work. Also, some ideas related to alternative sources of phosphorus for crop production. We see fertilizer phosphorus that's being produced from wastewater streams. How does it behave? Other less soluble forms like rock phosphate that supply not only phosphorus, but also calcium. And there's some other byproducts out there, like, for example, learned that there's quite a bit of bentonite from canola oil filtration at the canola crushing plants that, in fact, needs to find a home and not in a landfill. And maybe there's an opportunity for it to be used in land applications. So looking towards some work like doing some work on that down the road. Folks, of course, as we know, all this type of work, that's not an individual effort, it's a team effort. So folks in that building there on the left-hand side across campus, very, very important part of what we do. And in particular, my research team, who are just incredible, graduate students, postdoctoral fellows, research associates, summer students, technicians, make this really happen. And they're what really make it go. And undergraduate student projects as well. I think I've had just about 200 of those over the years. And they've also been a great way to take a look at what goes on out there in the field and how things work on a farm field scale. Lots of collaborations with agencies out there, and I've thrown up a few acronyms out there of different ones there, and there's a lot more than that. So I'm really appreciative of that. And also, I'm very happy that along the way, I've had my farm that I've been able to use as a site for research work, including not only just small plot work, but also landscape scale research. I know that in some cases, some of the work that we did on the subsoiling, our plots were about 8 acres for each plot. So to do the study took about a half a quarter or a quarter section. So that was great. And also my spouse, Lynn, who's contributed very much to the research efforts over the year. And also the other land access I've had from the university, the LFCE, and also I would mention as well, the phytotron, very, very, very important to my research efforts over the years in my program. So I guess, folks, to wrap it up, I always like to think if we look after our soils, they will indeed look after us. And finally, I'd like to thank the Government of Agriculture, or Government of Saskatchewan, Ministry of Agriculture, the Strategic Research Program, and the ADF program for support of the soil nutrient management research that we do, as well as other funding partners and sources in their government ones, and lots of other support from industry, checkoff groups, huge numbers of those, and lots of private industry support over the years as well. So thank you very much for the opportunity to share some thoughts, and thank you very much again, Trevor, for the opportunity to come out and tell folks a little bit about what we do in our program.
Perfect. Well, thanks. Exactly. Thanks, Jeff. Danielle, is there any questions online? If you can maybe just, we've got lots of time for questions. So here in person or online, if there are questions for Jeff, well, we've got them. Go ahead, over here.
Yeah, wait, I'll bring this to you so that people online can hear.
Hey, Jeff. Such an amazing work that's really important in the hands of producers and agrologists and everything. I was wondering, what do you find to be the most effective way to get, you know, that information from your work out to people so that they can use it?
That's an excellent question. And I guess, and I've thought a lot about it, and I was actually inspired very much by Professor Les Henry. Get out there, the rubber hits the road, and you know, we've got some wonderful tools now, webinars, but still nothing beats going out there, and even in a small, you know, Legion Hall in a small town with even just a small group of producers, I think that's where it starts. And I think that that there's so many different ways, but I still think that that face-to-face is really a very effective way to get the message out. There's a lot of great farm media out there as well, and they're eager to do interviews and to talk to scientists, to researchers, and they do a really great job. And typically, almost all of them give you a chance to look at the copy before it goes out. And I really appreciate that too, because I'm a kind of ummer and ah and mumbler. And I always like the chance to have a chance to go through, oh yeah, well, that was kind of a dumb statement. I better reword. But that's a great way to get the message out too, Jeremy.
Thank you. Thanks for the talk, Jeff. That was excellent. I have a question for you. You know, typically prairie agriculture is one of the agriculture regions that has the lowest environmental impact. We have very low N2O emissions. We have pretty good carbon. We don't actually use a lot of pests, don't use a lot of biocides. We're pretty good. So some people, and this just a conversation I had this morning, suggested we should stop doing research in the prairies and focus on Ontario, who let's just say maybe aren't as good. So I have two questions for you. Are we just lucky or are we good? And what is the next big environmental challenge for like our region, the prairies region?
Yeah, that's that. Thanks, Steve. That's, you know, that's very insightful. And I like the question, you know, what's the reason? And I think it's a bit of a combination. We're lucky because it is dry. And you think, and I sit there when I look at, I watch the weather and how, okay, I figure we're lucky if we get 2 or 3 centimeters of snow. And then down east, you're like getting 30 centimeters a day. And you think, wow, there's a lot of water that's kind of flushing through that system and it's carrying stuff with it. Here it moves, you know, a few millimeters a year down. There it moves meters. So I think we're lucky in that respect. But I also think that, you know, that we've had the opportunity as well to apply some good management. And we've been fortunate. In fact, those tough times that I talked about in the 80s, as bad as they were, and they were pretty horrible. And a lot of people they left the farm, but the people, you know, how do you survive? You have to become efficient. And so that direct seeding system, the zero till, really evolved. You know, I mean, it had did great things for the soil and keeping it in place. But the big thing was you burned less fuel, you wore out less equipment. And so that was a consequence of that. And the ability, I think the ingenuity of the folks that designed and built the equipment that made it work, the extension efforts to get that message out to growers, and the research work that supported it made it all happen. And I also like to think as well, you know, here we were lucky enough, we got into the manure production maybe on a larger scale, a little bit later than other areas. So we had the opportunity to do it right. And to manage it as a nutrient source, a fertilizer, rather than a waste disposal issue. So I think that is that management coming on stream and support right from the beginning has also helped Steve. Yeah.
Any other questions here? Anything online, Daniel? There's one. What?
Thanks, Trevor. So Stephen Crittenden online was interested in hearing more on whether or not the building productivity of eroded knolls was published or not. Now, I know that is an ongoing study for you still that's ending this year, correct?
Yeah.
So what I did for Stephen was I provided a link to an article that was published in Grain News.
Okay.
Yeah. And providing a little bit more information on the study, but as well, I'm sure that Jeff, you would welcome questions from him.
And there's a lot of good work that's going on in Manitoba related that as well by Dr. David Laub and Curtis Cavers. And they also are doing some economic analysis, I believe, in that. We were interested in giving it a go in Saskatchewan on some really eroded knolls. And I think what's kind of interesting is, and about that, I think last year was the end of the study. Our final report's coming up in June, and we made some presentations on it. But we had two really, really dry years. And, you know, in those years like 2021, you got to be careful how you interpret things because it can make things kind of, you know, our fertilizer treatments in that study really never gave us any response at all. And that topsoil was king. And it was king because it did a lot of other things apart from just supply nutrients. Now, when it did rain last year, some in 2022, interestingly, in this last year of the study, we found that those fertilizer treatments, particularly the balanced ones, were starting to approach what we were getting from our topsoil replacement. So you always got to kind of give things time in order to see the whole effect. And because the climate in Saskatchewan, it's so variable from year to year, that's why we need to have lots of site years of data in order to really effectively tell the story.
So I'm always reminded of the story of a policeman who comes upon a drunk man who's walking around underneath the lamppost, and he says, "Oh, why are you here?" He says, "I'm looking for my car keys." "Oh, but your car's over there." He says, "Well, but I can only see here." So the reason I ask this is because I know that you and I are both very interested in phosphorus. And Derek would, well, he might not agree with, but he's also very interested in phosphorus. So as you know, that I'm a strong believer in organic phosphorus as like the key biological driver for microbial activities. And I'm wondering about, I know at the cyclotron, you guys are limited to inorganic. And I'm thinking back to your early sulfur days. The big story in sulfur is the organic sulfur, how important that is.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you were to look forward, you know, maybe Blake's career 20 years from now when he's like 40. And, you know, what do you think he'll be looking at organic phosphorus or still more inorganic phosphorus?
You know, that's an excellent question, Stephen. And I, when I first put my notes together for 312, and I had a in those notes, and I went back and I found them. And from the work that Bob McKercher had done, because Bob McKercher, professor emeritus in our department, and some of you may remember Bob, and he did work on organic phosphorus. And one of the things I put in my notes was that, from his work, a lot of the organic phosphorus in soil remains unidentified and unknown. And I realized I never took that out of my notes. I've left that in there for 30 years. So maybe that says something, but I think, you know, I think of the tools, the P31 NMR, and I know we've talked, Steve, about some of the new separation techniques. So yeah, I think, you know, it kind of comes to the ability to unravel the nature of that mysterious humus in that soil and what it's made of and what actually makes it tick. So yeah, I mean, I think some of the organic characterization for all the nutrients is perhaps, and you asked me that, you know, kind of one of the frontiers, certainly when it comes to the basics of understanding the nutrient cycling processes. But all of those basics all translate into being able to predict things like nutrient transport with water, nitrous oxide production, methane consumption, and all those other important things that and of course the hydrocarbons that you look at, Steve, when you're looking at your reclamation strategies in the hydrocarbon contaminated soils.
Okay, any other questions? Anything more online, Danielle? So I might have one, Jeff. We've got a few younger researchers here and maybe online. What advice might you give to a up-and-coming starting researcher based on your experiences and encouragement pitfalls to watch for?
I guess what I would say, probably the one thing is to get out there and talk to people. And maybe it doesn't, again, amount to as much of getting physically out there, but especially, you know, even in the early stages and you've just started some work, get out there, present it, talk to people, talk to your audience. And that's not only scientists, but industry and government and the general public. And you might be surprised at the insight that some of those folks have in relation to what you've done and how it can be applied. And that really, really helped me along. And I guess I use as an example of that, PRS, which related all the way back to work that was done in Jeff Bettany's lab and the technician there, Jackie Moyer, who was working with resins in a bead form, and they were awful to work with. You know, how can we make this better? And then the realization, hey, these resins come in a strip. And ooh, that makes them easy to use, but maybe they could be a little bit even easier to use if you put them in something you could stick them in and put it right in the soil. And there's another scientist who is a great inspiration to me, Dr. Stan Barber. He's from Whitewood and he's passed away now, but he went to Purdue University and he wrote a book called Soil Nutrient Bioavailability. Dr. John Stewart taught that in his graduate class, and it made me think really hard about the fact that a plant really doesn't have access to a nutrient unless the nutrient can move from where it is in another place in the soil for that root surface. So hence the kind of the idea, how can we make this as a root simulator? So talking to people, reading, class experience, as many different experiences as you can get, Trevor, I think is the key. Don't just stay in your office. Get out there. Yeah.
Perfect. Well, last chance for any questions or comments. Well, folks, please join me again in thanking Jeff for a great conversation.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks a bunch.
That was fun.
Perfect.